Hi, I'm Alexa Petrenko. I have to tell you, life doesn't get much better than this, and I want to advise you to please turn off your cell phones, not only if you're a classical club member in our concert lobby, but also wherever you are. And if you're near a computer, go to classical963fm.com because you're going to want to see this as well as hear it. So everything is right with the world. The sun is shining. The stocks are going up. We have one of the most exciting opera singers in the world in our concert lobby. Her name is Sondra Radvanovsky. Here's what the critics say about her. They say her voice is radiant, luminous, mesmerizing, brilliant, rapturous. She's a singer of soul-piercing intensity. The Italian press really love her. This is my favorite quote. They say she's vocally hot, powerful, and flexible, lyrical and dramatic, capable of agile dominance. I like that one a lot. And just before we hear her sing, I have to give you one more. Once she went into fifth gear and began delivering long runs of notes, blending fluidity and strength, there was nothing to do but fasten your seatbelt and be glad you were along for the ride. Well, that's the kind of hour it's going to be right now. Please welcome soprano Sondra Radvanovsky. She's going to sing music from Puccini. This is from Suor Angelica, Senza Mamma.
So
Live from our concert lobby here at the New Classical 96.3 FM, soprano Sondra Radvanovsky. I saw classical club members all around me melting. And at one point, if you were watching on classical963fm.com, where we're streaming live, when you sang the loud high note, it went on buffer overflow, whatever that means. So,
we're not used to such
beautiful sounds. Oh, you've been told that before.
Big mouth.
That was absolutely beautiful. Senza Mama from Suor Angelica, music by Puccini, yes. Which you sing just as nicely as Verdi, I have to say.
Well, thank you. You just
performed this recently in LA
with Domingo. September, October with Placido Domingo out there in Los Angeles Opera. Yeah.
You got rave reviews, of course, of their whole triptych. I think they singled out your performance.
Yeah, it was an interesting production in that Woody Allen did his very first directing job in Johnny Skeeky.
Not of Suor Angelica,
ours,
though.
No, William Friedkin did ours. So.
That's right. Exorcist guy. That's right.
Exorcist
you were telling
guy.
Me about
No heads turning, though.
But tell me about Domingo now, the Domingo connection. Domingo has been sort of a thread in your professional life from the beginning, pretty much.
Yeah, actually. I heard Placido on TV when I was 11 years old, and I said to my mom, I want to do that. And she said, yeah, honey, okay, yeah, great. And I said, no, really, I want to do that. So I started taking voice lessons at 11 years old and actually met Placido Domingo when I was 26 years old at the Metropolitan Opera. He was singing Stifelio, and I was doing this little part called Dorotea in Stifelio. And he pulled me aside and said, you know, I think you have an amazing talent. I don't know how he got that from like one line, but. And I had an audition for him, and we have been fast friends since I was 26. And actually, on my 35th birthday, my life dream came true at 35, if you can believe that. I was starting rehearsals for Cyrano de Bergerac at the Metropolitan Opera with Placido Domingo as Cyrano, and I was Roxanne. And he sang Happy Birthday to me and got me a birthday cake. And we started rehearsals. And my dream was to sing a leading role with Placido Domingo. And there it was.
And wait, there's more, though, right? Because you said, I'm 35 and
this is my dream.
It's come true. And what do I do now?
And
what did
he say?
And he said,
get a different dream. So what are you supposed to say to that? Okay.
Well, so are you working on it? I mean,
I am.
What do you do about that?
Placido is still very involved in my career and in my life. And so now I'm singing with him more in a conductor facility. I just did Lucrezia Borgia in Washington with him conducting. So we're always collaborating, and we have some things up our sleeves, possibly for Los Angeles Opera with Placido, too. So a little more Puccini, possibly. And what do? You go on and you find another dream, and I'm starting some new repertoire that's really exciting. So.
And one of the dreams, I think, is singing Tosca, which we're going to hear a sample from in a moment.
Singing
yes,
Tosca. I'm doing my very first Tosca next year.
Right. Yeah. Let's hear the big aria, Vici d'arte.
D'arte.
Live from our concert lobby here at the New Classical 96.3 FM. Oh, yes, and if you're at a computer, go to classical963fm.com and watch this as well as listen to it. Here's Sondra Radvanovsky with Vici d'arte from Puccini's Tosca. Thank you. Live from our concert lobby here at Classical 96.3 FM, soprano Sondra Radvanovsky with Visi d'arte, Tosca's big aria from Puccini's opera. So listen, we're going to introduce the family. Your accompanist, Don Tarnowski.
Yes.
The page turner, Duncan Lear, who's your husband. And the reason I'm doing this family thing is while you were singing, this email came in from someone called Bob Radvanovsky.
He said, brother.
He says it utterly amazes that now I can listen to my sister perform remotely. I wanted to wish her well on today's performance. Break a leg, kiddo. Bro.
Aww. All the way from Chicago, Illinois.
Isn't that nice? All right, we have to take a commercial break. When we come back, we're going to talk about a typical day in the life of an opera singer, because when Sondra arrived like half an hour ago, she was going, oh, it's so early, Stay tuned to find out what an opera singer would normally be doing at this time of day. We're live in our concert lobby here at Classical 96.3 FM. Back in a moment.
Great.
And now the purple dusk of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. High up in the sky, the little stars climb, always reminding me that we're apart. You wander down the lane and far away, leaving me a song that will not die. Love is now the stardust of yesterday, the music of the years gone by.
Hi, my name is Alexa Petrenko. Here I am in our concert lobby, surrounded by Classical Club members and possibly the greatest soprano living today. Well, I think anyway, Sondra Radvanovsky. She's been called a Verdi soprano. We just heard her in a bunch of Puccini. We're about to hear her in some songs in a break from the opera triathlon. Yeah. We'll hear her in some Duparc songs. But first, Sondra, when you came in, you were going, oh, it's so early. So let's talk about the typical day in the life of an opera singer. What time would you normally get up?
Well, first off, I have to say there's never really a typical day.
Oh, excellent. Lucky you.
Never a typical day, which is great. John Van Driel and I were talking about that, and that I could never do a 9-to-5 job because it's just not my personality. But normally, a typical day, okay, if there is a typical day, on a performance day, we'll wake up around 11 o'clock. Because, you know, your whole workday is shifted because you have to be at the prime of your day at 8 o'clock in the evening. Yeah. And still be up until normally midnight and still be, you know, alive and breathing and ready to go.
Well, dinner's at midnight, right? After the performance,
yeah, well, generally. If the performance is not even, you know, Trovatore usually isn't even over until midnight, except the Met was a very quick production that we just did, but because it was on a turntable, so everything moved very quickly, which is nice. But the problem is, for singers, you go from rehearsal period, where you're starting rehearsal at 10 or 11 in the morning, so you have to be adjusted to a morning schedule, and then all of a sudden, it changes one day to an evening schedule.
It's like shift work.
See, it is, but it's two shifts that they happen all of a sudden. So it's a little tiring, plus the travel, it gets a bit tiring. And I just flew in from New York after being there for 2 months, and it's exhausting. But I love what I do. Thank you very much.
So what do you sacrifice for your art? I mean, they're always sacrifices.
A lot of sacrifices. I think a lot of people think that what we do, we sit in a hotel room and eat bonbons all day, and, you know.
Oh, do you eat bonbons? Halls, probably. Throat lozenges.
A throat lozenge. Yeah. No, you know, it's not a glamorous life per se. Yes, we get to meet a lot of celebrities and be invited to a lot of high-end kind of galas and things. And you get to dress up a lot, which is always fun. But honestly, the day in and day out of it is just a lot of watching your voice, not screaming, not drinking too much the night before a show, or worrying about reflux. And, you know, if it's really cold in New York, you don't want to go out for a walk or things like that. And there's a lot of business aspect to it that people just really don't know, all the publicity that we have to do and interviews and things like this. And, you know, it takes up a lot of time.
Lobby concerts.
Lobby concerts, but I love coming here, and you know
there
that.
You go.
So,
all right, let's have some more singing. This is, opera singers don't just sing opera. They also, I mean, Roy Thompson Hall has a great recital series.
Absolutely.
By opera singers. Hopefully you'll be in that sometime soon.
Hint,
I don't know
hint,
if anybody from TSO or Roy Thompson is here. But we're going to hear some songs by Henri Duparc. This is some of the most beautiful song repertoire written in French.
They really, and they're very operatic in a way anyway. So that's why I really love these songs. And excuse me, I have to use the music, so.
All right, and I guess you get some heavy lifting in this, right? The pianist is Don Tarnowski. The soprano is Sondra Radvanovsky, live from our concert lobby here at the new Classical 96.3 FM. And if you're near a computer, go to classical963fm.com. We are streaming live. lobby here at the New Classical 96.3 FM. Soprano Sondra Radvanovsky with her accompanist Don Tarnowski. A couple of songs by Henri Duparc. The first one was Chanson Triste, and the second one, Au pays où se fait la guerre. Absolutely beautiful.
Thank you.
And your French is très bon.
Merci beaucoup.
Let me ask you about languages. You're in a business where everybody certainly performs in several languages, sure, and speaks several languages, sure, and you work with conductors who are from different cultures. Sure. I mean, everybody is multilingual in this business.
Mostly, yes. Yes, I think North American singers especially, because English is our first language, and we go over to Europe, you have to have a second language.
Don't all the European conductors speak English?
No.
Oh,
no.
Oh, the Italian ones maybe not so
no.
much.
No, maybe they do. They just don't speak it to me.
So tell me about learning languages. I mean, you've sung Rusalka. That's got to be, I have a fear of Czech. That's got to be the hardest language to learn to sing.
Czech and Russian, but I have a Czech background. My father was Czech.
Ah.
So he and my grandmother spoke Czech all the time at home. So I have a little leg up on
that.
Have
it in your ear.
Yeah. But Russian, definitely.
So how do you memorize? I mean, these songs you were singing off the music, opera,
right,
you have to memorize. How do you go about memorizing something?
Well, it depends on what it is. You definitely have to, what I do is I listen, if I have an opera coming up, a new opera, say for instance, Tosca, I take a listen to it once or twice just to hear, and I, with the score in front of me.
Who have you been listening to? Do you model?
Always Maria Callas.
Oh, really?
Maria Callas.
All right. Oh, yes, and one of the critics has said that they detect hints of Callas in your voice. Is that because you listen to her a lot?
No, I don't. I hope not. I hate people that imitate.
Yeah, okay.
But I think that what she did as an artist, which she was never afraid to make ugly noises as well as beautiful noises, but always it was about the music and about the text. And I really admire that about her singing. But also, I listened to Leontine Price. I listened to Régine Crespin, as we had talked before. Many singers, but I definitely have my favorites. So
then it's in your ear once you've heard it.
I listen to it with my score, and I will mark certain passages that I know that I'm going to have to look at, or where the orchestra is very loud, or things like that, things that I know I'll have to look at. Then I put the recording away, because I think if you listen too often, you mimic. And often time singers nowadays, they just mimic. They sound like a carbon copy of whoever singing something, and I want to sound like me. So then you go through that. Then you speak the words, and luckily I speak Italian. That is my other language. And I go through the language, okay, if there's any words I don't know, and I translate it myself word for word, which takes a very long time. And then you start working on the passages with a coach, by yourself, and finally then you go on stage and start rehearsing it. And it depends upon how long the opera is, how long it takes.
And then you have to remember your words and your music while you're like lying down or whatever the latest director has decided to make you do, right?
Well, I get on my back a lot, and I don't know. On my back and barefoot. That just seems the trend for me lately. I don't know. Maybe they like my feet. I don't know.
All right. Well, in just a moment, we'll hear music from the latest opera where you had to lie on your back and barefoot. And then your signature role, Leonora, in Verdi's Il Trovatore. But first, we're going to take a break. We are live in our concert lobby here at the New Classical 96.3 FM with soprano Sondra Radvanovsky.
I know, it's a
mouthful.
It'd
be nice if
I
could get your name.
It's a mouthful.
And you can also watch this if you go to classical963fm.com. We're streaming live. Back in just a moment.
And now the purple dusk of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. High up in the sky, the little stars climb, always reminding me that we're apart. You wander down the lane and far away, leaving me a song that will not die. Love is now the stardust of yesterday, the music of the years gone by.
Well, it should be illegal to have this much fun. Here we are live in our concert lobby at the New Classical 96.3 FM. I'm Alexa Petrenko. I have the great privilege of chatting with soprano Sondra Radvanovsky. And just before we do chat, you know what happened during that last intermission? Well, an email came in from someone called Tammy Radvanovsky.
Our family.
And she said, what an amazing time for such an amazing woman. Please let Sondra know that I have my whole office listening to her performance here in Chicago. We are so proud of her accomplishments. Love you. Your sister-in-law, Tammy Radvanovsky.
Go.
There you go.
There's only one more. That's just my mom, and I promise she won't write.
Are you sure?
You know what? She won't, because she's too embarrassed. Yeah, she won't do that. Okay. So that's it. There's no more Radvanovskys, I promise.
So listen, you're just back from the Met, where you sang your, I guess, signature role, the role that first sprunged you to fame, Leonora, Verdi's Il Trovatore.
Yeah.
You were named a Verdi soprano. You had the typical Met experience of the revolving tenors, right? The tenors always get sick. Restaging, you have to retrain a new tenor.
Well, actually, there was no restaging and no retraining, unfortunately. Marcelo Alvarez, our tenor in the show, well, Trovatore at the Met is cursed. I should just say that right off. Every production has been bad.
Well, wait, so is Puritani. I mean, they're all...
It's true, is it? Well, but Trovatore at the Met has... Everybody says, oh, Trovatore. Oh, you're going to do
that. It's like Macbeth. I like it.
It really is. It's a cursed production. Okay. So we were all sick for the opening night, all of us. And then the tenor actually canceled halfway through a show. Halfway through a show.
Ooh.
10 minutes into the intermission, because there's only one intermission in this production, he says, I'm not going to go on. His cover had never sang on the Met stage before. Poor guy was not warmed up. Had 10 minutes to get in makeup, wig, and warm up and start with Di Quella Pira.
Was he any good?
He did a great job.
Did he? So he's now been discovered? I mean, this is how you get discovered, right?
Yeah, yeah. And he ended up doing the whole show after that.
But so what's his name?
Philip Webb.
All right, watch for Philip
Webb. American from Chicago.
Go Chicago. All right.
And he did a very good job, and we had no rehearsal with him. He just went in.
Yeah. Nerves of steel.
Well, he was shaking like a leaf. I mean, a poor guy, he's walking on stage and he's shaking. And I was like, you know, okay, it's okay, it's okay. It's okay, Philip, it's okay.
So have you been in a Met simulcast yet?
I have not. We have one planned for this Trovatore. They didn't do it this year because there wasn't enough time. In 2011, I think they're planning it.
So this has kind of changed a lot for opera singers. Like, no longer do you just have to be able to sing and move on stage. Yeah. You now have close-ups. You now are expected to be a movie star as well. And you have to, like, act. And you, I like this, after Suor Angelica, there's an article about you, and you said, no more opera acting for me, no siree.
No more opera acting. That. Well, you know, it's kind of like here now. You have everything live streamed on the web. It's people want the whole experience. They want the whole package. They want the voice. They want the body. They want the acting. And opera acting is just so dated. And I think it's possible, especially with these simulcasts, it's bringing opera to such a greater masses of people. People that can't come, for instance, to New York to see something at the Metropolitan Opera can go to your local movie theater and see something just as good, if not better, because you get the backstage tour, you get the personal interviews by Renee Fleming, and it's really exciting. I mean, I want to see one, you know?
But if you're toning it down for the camera. I mean, how does that affect, you know, people in a 2,000 seat theater? Are they now not getting their money's worth because you're acting for the camera, not to fill this huge theater? Well, I don't know how this
is going
to work.
I think if you put the intensity with it, and that's what I mean by no more opera acting, because opera acting, you know, we've all seen this, right? You know,
you mean Pavarotti left arm, right arm?
I love you. Yes.
Yeah.
No. I think if you put the intensity behind it, and there is a lady here that actually saw the show in New York. Yeah. Ooh. Did it read in the audience? I think I didn't do opera acting, but I have to say that, if you put the intensity and the passion and the expression into it, I think the audience feels it.
Yeah.
You know, and you don't have to do it. It's dated. And that is why people talk about opera being old and opera. But that's why I think the simulcasts are really, really helping the world of opera.
Let's hear one of the arias that you are famous for. Can you set this up?
This is D'Amor sulla Rose from Il Trovatore, the fourth act, where I am going to find my tenor, whichever tenor it is, who has been taken away by Conte di Luna, taken to prison, and I am going to look for him, being the brave Joan of Arc type of woman. And I stop, the whole opera stops, and I sing D'Amor sulla Rose, a song to him who's in prison. Take my love and send it on the wings of the air and let him know that I love him.
Live from our concert lobby, here is soprano Sondra Radvanovsky. You're listening to Classical 96.3 FM, and you can also see this. We're streaming live at classical963fm.com.
Salvarlo io potrò, forse.
Live from our concert lobby here at the New Classical 96.3 FM, soprano Sondra Radvanovsky, pianist Don Tarnowski. That was D'Amore sulla Lali Rose, her one of your signature
Thank
roles,
you.
Leonora, from Verdi's Il Trovatore.
Thank you.
Sondra Radvanovsky, Don Tarnowski. So listen, while you were singing, an email
arrived.
There are
arrived. No more Radvanovskys, I promise.
It reads, this is the last and best of the Radvanovskys. Great going, darling daughter, love, Mom.
She did! Hi, Mom!
I love this family.
Aw, that's really lovely. Thanks, Mom.
All right, Sondra, let's talk briefly about the future. Now, you haven't sung at the COC before, and I've heard rumors that Alexander Neef may have snapped you up. Yes? True?
Yes.
Possibly?
I cannot say what, but I can say that it is in 2010, correct? 2010.
Yay.
So I will be coming to Canada. Finally, finally.
And soon we will be able to have you in our own iPods. You have two CDs coming out.
Yes, I have a duet CD coming out with Dmitry Havorostovsky, unfortunately. Yeah, just a terrible, ugly baritone. Yeah. And that should be coming up in the next few months. And then also my first solo CD of all Verdi arias around October. So yes, on Delos. So look for it in the record store soon. And on my website.
Which is?
SondraRadvanovsky.com. There you go.
All right. Thank you so much for coming in, Sondra. Don, thank you so much for Valiant Playing. Classical Club members, thank you so much for joining the club and for coming. And now you have a wonderful lunch to enjoy. And we are coming up to the 1 o'clock news with David Bale. I'm Alexa Petrenko, live from our concert lobby here at the New Classical 96.3 FM.